Blitz is defined as a sudden savage attack. It is indeed all this. The effect is sure. The premise is simple. It's a basic primal confrontation, man to man. No excuses are offered, none accepted.
Welcome to the latest edition of Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com.
Looks like a radio station.
Now, here are your hosts, lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers.
Pure athlete, yeah.
I transcend race, hombre.
Matt Butler.
I don't talk man. I back it up.
And we are chock full of that, man.
Damn right.
And Jeff Howe.
It's still real to me, damn it.
And that's the bottom line. Cause Stone Cold said so.
If you're gonna blitz, come strong, but don't come at all.
Coming strong with another edition of Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com. I am Jeff Howe. Going to be a shorter blitz than normal. I've got to get over to the dish.
The
baseball dish. Availability today. Baseball season starting this weekend. Looking forward to the beginning.
Thank God.
The start of the David Pierce era. Yeah, with the way basketball season is going.
With that football season. Yeah, man.
Something.
Come on, baseball. Let's go. Longhorn baseball. Let's go. Texas women's basketball, though, I don't want to.
Women's basketball is carrying the flag
women's
right
basketball
now,
is wrecking shop, so I don't want to hate
man,
on
that,
all the sports.
That volleyball team was kicking butt recently, too. The women's,
they
I guess,
always
they
do.
Always pay attention.
Jared Alley, always, they always wreck shop.
I actually watched, like, the last bit of regulation in the two overtimes of the women's game the other night.
Yeah. No, I'm telling you, our women's team is really good. Texas women's
team is
really good.
I watched probably about the last 5 minutes of the Baylor game last week. So, yeah. No, it's Karen Aston's crew getting it done.
Start off on a positive note.
You know, we'll see if Tom Herman's crew can get it done. Obviously, we won't find out for sure until September 2nd. It's a long way away, man.
We get a preview, though.
We get a preview. Spring practice officially. Tom Herman has some tentative dates set, but spring practice officially gets underway Tuesday, March 7th.
I'm going to write that down.
So, mark your calendars, Longhorn fans. Now, I haven't heard about if practices will be open, what practices will be open, if there will be any practices open, other than the spring game, which I believe is set for April 15th, I believe, if I'm thinking about that right. That
sounds about right.
2 months.
So, we'll at least get to see the Longhorns at least once before heading into summer. So, take that for whatever it's worth. But we'll talk plenty of spring ball here and everything surrounding it. On this edition of Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com. I am Jeff Howe. Like I said, shorter show, so let's get right to it. Let me bring in the rest of the team. He's the master of the soundboard, the drop machine extraordinaire, the man behind the glass, and he is celebrating a birthday today. He is one Matt
what?
Butler.
You're correct. Nice. Yes.
Appreciate it, fellas.
If you were on Facebook, Rod, you would know these things.
See, this is right. Yeah. You know what? Yeah, because you don't.
That's about
Twitter.
The only handy thing Facebook is. Is
yeah,
all the,
Twitter
well,
doesn't do. Twitter
we love our
like
Facebook Live
you.
Audience,
exactly.
By the way. Not
yeah.
our Facebook
Sorry,
Live audience.
Facebook Live.
The
we love you
no,
guys.
It's awesome that we get to use Facebook as a TV, basically, to send ourselves
yeah, right.
out. But
that's
yes,
a
that is a very handy thing. They can always get themselves in with a happy birthday.
Yeah,
day.
Twitter should steal that. It's just sending people like notifications and whatever of your. Your when your friends your circle are having birthdays, yeah, because that's cool that Facebook
yeah.
does that. Well, how old are you? Happy birthday!
I'm 33. I'm weird
You're
when I was
man.
Thinking about numbers because I just realized that now more of my life has been lived on this side of 2000. I was like, I was born and turned 16
oh,
in the year
point.
2000, and I was like, man. Now it's 17 years since it's been 2000, so yeah, it's a big number, but enjoying it.
Yeah, that's it's because you're a cusp guy on the cusp of millennialism. Yeah,
what is
you know
the cusp?
Because
like
I'm on the cusp of it. I'm
you're
with you.
Literally on the border.
Yeah,
and I'm
I spent 20 years in you know kind of the 19s, 1980 plus, and then I've spent now was 17 years in 2000. So yeah, I'm right on the cusp.
See, you got more than 1900s in you than I do.
You unique perspective of the 20th century.
Yes,
now we're
yes.
into the 21st.
You're an
century.
Old school. You're a 20th century individual.
I'm an old man.
That's a good 20th century Renaissance
Dude,
man.
By the way, speaking of 20th century. Your 20th century pop culture. Your shirt is awesome.
Oh, yes.
Have people seen his shirt?
I don't know.
Can we get his t-shirt?
I love Gizmo.
It's grim. It's a Gremlin shirt with Gizmo on it. Dude, I want that shirt so bad.
I got it at Target for $9.99.
I'm going
back
to Target.
Summer.
Target today.
Target.
To go get that shirt.
Fancy.
That shirt. I love that shirt, man.
Ain't nobody got anything on the Gremlins, Gizmo, and then Gremlins 2 is just out of control
also,
whenever like they take over New York.
Underrated Christmas movies. The Gremlins. The Gremlins series is all mostly Christmas movies.
Yes,
you're underrated
right.
Christmas movies.
Yes. He shops at Target. He can tell you about underrated Christmas movies. That's why he's a Renaissance man himself, the Renaissance man of this show. Our lockdown corner on the show, and the third member of our team, lifetime Longhorn, 2002 UT All-American, 2002 semifinalist for the Jim Thorpe Award, fourth round draft choice of the New York Giants in 2003, spent his NFL career with the Giants, Lions, Bears, Bucks, Broncos, and a year with the Hamilton Tiger Cats of the CFL when he was done with football, got himself back to Austin, Texas in the 40 Acres where he earned his degree. If he had a T-ring, he'd wear it proudly. He is a card-carrying member of DBU, the pride of Lamar High School, number 21 in your program, number one in your hearts, Mr. Rod Babers. Rod, we got a request.
Glad you're bringing up Lamar High School. Lamar's still representing, man,
yes,
pumping out DBs and great athletes. I'm proud. Still proud of Tom Nolan, the Al Davis of HISD, as I call him.
We got a request to bring this up. So we know, obviously, Lamar has produced a lot of talent over the last few years. John Bonney, Holton Hill, a lot of guys coming out of the Lamar program. But when you look right now, the DB lineage continues with this 2018 class.
Yeah.
Anthony Cook is a five-star prospect. Yep. Deshaun Jameson is one of the top corner prospects in the state. Mm-hmm. Just keeps going, Rod.
It's DB high, baby. It is. I'm serious. I think it's DB high. I really do. I would put Lamar High School up against any school in Texas in the at least since I was, playing,
said 99.
Like, since, like, 99. Since basically just the modern recruiting ranking started, I'd put Lamar up against anybody in terms of developing defensive back talent. You know what I mean?
If you're talking about historically, there's a two-man class that would challenge you, which would be West Orange Stark, which they can boast Kevin Smith and Earl Thomas.
That is true.
Somebody else from Gilmore around Curtis Brown? Wasn't that a decent one? But you're right, Rod. Houston Lamar is great.
I'm just saying they pumping them out. I'm not saying all time greats. I'm just saying since 99, maybe it's a Tom Nolan thing. It's really good DBs, man. Really good DBs.
And even before the DBs, I mean, you were a one, but then you had the Arakpo, and then Kelson at that same time coming out of there.
Drum Sapp was a five star.
And then all these DBs.
Yeah, number one player in the state.
Yeah,
I believe he's number one on the Fab 55.
Oh, so wasn't Kelson a five star basically?
Back when the Fab 55 was how I got my recruiting information.
I remember
in
the Fab 55. Yeah.
Yeah. What was it? Christmas they put it on it, or New Year's Day?
I think
Day?
It was like Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
That
was all I knew of recruiting. Once a year, I read the Fab 55 from the Statesman, and boom, you knew it all.
Nice.
So
that was it.
The game has changed, but what has not changed is Houston Lamar still producing quality defensive back prospects.
That's right, baby. So, the Houston racial slurs, as they used to be known. Now they're the Texans.
Rod,
the
you need to get over there and Texans. Share some knowledge
I get the coaches giving me grief all the time that I don't come back enough. I need to come back. I need to go back and hang out. You know what I mean?
How many of your coaches are still there?
Not many. I want to say like maybe three of them.
Yeah.
It's weird. I know the names of your coaches, like Nolan Martinez and somebody else.
Coach Martinez. I think Martinez still might be there. He used to be the track coach. And then Coach Saldivar, who I believe is still there because he ended up marrying one of the teachers there.
Nice.
If I'm not mistaken. I wonder if Coach Makovic is still – not Makovic. I want to say maybe it is. I may be misremembering that name, though.
Nice.
But, yeah, I want to say a lot of them are still with Coach Nolan. Coach Nolan's been there forever, though.
All right. We will talk plenty about Lamar prospects because I'm sure Texas is recruiting Anthony Cook and Deshaun Jameson, so that will not be the last time we mention those two guys throughout the spring and throughout this recruiting cycle.
Yeah.
I want to move on to something, Rod. I don't know if you covered this on the buffet or not. Matt, I'm sure you're aware of it. This, we called a situation, I don't know, this deal with Sam Ellinger and Dylan Haynes.
Yeah.
Oh,
I've seen it
something
Twitter.
On this.
So,
yeah, I've seen it.
I don't know.
I saw it last night.
I don't know if like I said, I don't know what you want to label this, right?
Yeah.
But it seemed, I'm taking it as a kind of just a lighthearted deal, kind of. But I kind of want to read into it a little bit more because it seemed like there was something other than just, hey, we're having some playful jabs back and forth. Like it seemed like there was.
Some people are playing it down like it wasn't meant to be.
At first, that's what I thought.
Yeah, they weren't meant to put each other down. Like they're just it's playful banter.
Right.
Yeah. It seemed to me that there was a little bit more angst involved. The dig seemed personal.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. You can go over the timeline. But they, to me, I just my observation, I don't know any inside scoop on it or anything. I looked at it, I've seen guys jabbing at one another, like ex-teammates or, you know, old school, new school guys jabbing at one another, Quandre Diggs, and other guys jabbing at one another on Twitter and social media. And it didn't seem to get that personal. But maybe that's... Right. Maybe I'm missing something. Maybe I'm not that cool anymore. This is the Tosh.0 generation. So
getting personal sometimes
is no big deal.
And well, not exactly the personal part, but this generation, because, you know, at first off, it would go with the personalities. Like, I'm not the personality where me and my good friends, like, will just give each other hell all day long and make fun of each other. But I do have close friends that I'm close friends with that, like, that's all they do is enjoy razzing one another with their personality. True. So when I saw that, I was like, oh, man. This is like back in the day when John and Sam were going at it or somebody. And then I immediately was like, well, but if I grew up on social media, I know that they would tag each other. And I see them give each other hell on social media these days. So I think it's more of just young generation being in front of us and displaying the entire relation, everything that they do in front of everybody. Now, that can also mean that you're also trying to dig at somebody.
I was gonna say, there's also beef.
For sure. And that's what I'm saying, that like, I remember good friends, like, bringing up very personal stuff with one another when they're trying to go at one another. And so, it is to say, like, just, you know, some teenage kids being competitive and messing with each other, and it's almost like a competition to say who can one-up the other. That's sort of the culture online when you look at, on Twitter, these back-and-forths, these beefs that you see between, like, you know, celebrities and stuff. Well, this just seemed like two 18-year-old kids that... don't mind if their beefs play out in front of everybody, because
Haynes is not eight. I mean, Dylan Haynes is old.
Oh, true. You're right.
Like,
you're
he's right. not. Like,
he's 21, 22.
Yeah, Dylan Haynes is like, he would think trying to go into a profession. So, you know what I mean? Like, he's a little bit older. I don't know. It was just kind of weird to me that they just kind of went at
each
other. It seemed.
Can we go over the tweets real quick?
Yeah.
Before we get too far down the road. Okay. Sam Ellinger, just kind of an innocuous tweet yesterday. If you're not willing to work and strain every day, the University of Texas football program is not the place for you. #1&0. Dylan Haynes responds, bro, you got no juice, with what looks like an orange emoji. And I don't know if that's playful. This is also
very similar to like how we saw the previous regime guys last time and then the new kids coming in. This is another rift of that, a previous regime guy and a new kid.
And then Sam Ellinger responds, correct me if I'm wrong, at Dylan Haynes forum, but and it's a photo from the turf at DKR. But isn't this the exact location that at @S_Russell17 Seth Russell hurdled you?
Boom. Oh yeah. That's what I'm saying. It got personal.
Oh
quick.
Yeah, for sure.
It escalated quickly.
Quandre Diggs might have had the
Quandre was funny throughout this whole thing.
LMAO, I'm done for today, man. I've laughed for the last 15 minutes. I think part of it was lighthearted, but there was some seriousness. No. Why I say that?
I think it can be both.
I that's kind of what I just said. I think there's a little bit of kind of a jab there. I think, and Rod, I just think it's part of trying to get the old mentality out and trying to bring kind of a new mentality on board. Because I mean, Sam Ellinger. Yeah, he was down with Charlie Strong, but let's not forget when Tom Herman was able to get out on the road and recruit, Sam Ellinger was, I think, the first stop he made. The first high school game was a Sam Ellinger game that Sam didn't even play in. He was hurt in that Lake Travis game. He didn't even play. So this is a guy that's completely on board with Tom Herman, with the message, with what this staff is trying to sell. And, again, I'm sure it was good-natured, but if it was something else – it wouldn't surprise me if it was, number one. And number two, I think that could just be a sign of maybe the new guard trying to establish, hey, this is the new Texas. This is the way we're doing things now, what have you. It doesn't matter if you're – just because I'm a freshman doesn't mean I don't have a right to say what I feel or what is the truth, which is, hey, if you're not willing to put in the work, maybe Texas isn't for you. And, Rod, to me, this is a bigger picture problem and something that we talked about. And Mac used to talk about this back in the heyday. The University of Texas isn't for everybody. It's not for everybody. It's a great institution. You can get a good education there. Great football, but man, it's not for everybody. And you know, there were plenty of guys that had success while you were on the 40 rod. But I'm sure there were plenty of guys. And I'm not saying Dylan Haynes is one of these guys. Clearly, when you go from walk on to earning your scholarship, you've done something right along the way. But there were plenty of guys, Rod, you played with, I'm sure, that once they signed on the dotted line and enrolled, they thought that was the end of the deal.
Yeah.
You know what? I think there are a lot of different things at play here. Dylan Haynes, first of all, this isn't the first time he's been on social media and said something that has aggravated folks or that has kind of lit the match, right, to kind of jumpstart a little bit of a dumpster fire. And, Sam Ehlinger kind of threw that, that statement out there. If you're not willing to work and strain every day, the University of Texas football program is not the place for you. I mean, that seemed pretty random, just kind of throwing it out there, motivational, whatever.
It's pretty innocuous. Yeah.
I don't even know why Dylan Haynes felt the need to come at him. That was, I think Sam Ehlinger was probably like that, like, oh, man, I didn't come at you, bro. Why are you coming at me, bro?
Why are you so defensive?
Yeah, like, why are you coming at me like that anyway? Like, you know what I mean? Like, coming at me, bro, you got no juice. Like, mm-hmm. What does it have to do with anything? You know what I mean? Like, why are you coming at him like that? So, Dylan Haynes, member of DBU like myself, he's got a kind of a personality that's kind of, I would say, it's confrontational. He's got this Napoleon complex because he's been a walk-on. I call it the walk-on complex almost. You know what I mean? Like, because he's at the fight. He's almost like this bulldog mentality because he's always been counted out, which is great. You know what I mean? It's good to have that.
Get you to where you're at.
You want to hire that guy. You want that guy on your team. You want him in your defensive backfield, obviously.
Right.
But you see some of that coming out on social media, too. Remember he said the thing about he got political at one point in his tweets. You know what I mean? He's got a bulldog in him. And he's not going to step down. Yeah, he's not going to step down. He likes confrontation. He likes coming at people.
There was the deal.
He's calling people out.
The deal 2 years ago after the big loss to TCU where we had that Monday where it was like, and I even forget now what he said, but it was like some guys don't want to work hard.
Yeah.
And then some guys on the team took offense to that. And it was like the whole thing that played out over Twitter that day, which was really weird.
He's one of those guys who take the good and the bad with him. And now he's a lifetime Longhorn like me. So he's always got the right to say whatever the hell he wants to whoever the hell wants in the program.
I've always agreed with that.
You know what I mean? That's straight up. I wouldn't have done it because I know that I can critique on the outside looking in, but that regime, listen, they govern themselves and they have the right to kind of culturalize their program the way they want to put their stamp on it. Even if I'm on the outside looking in and saying, man, they shouldn't do that. I don't like that. That's just me. I did it. We did it our way when we were there.
Right.
And we didn't have to deal with the outside distractions. That's their right. They are now going through their process. It's going to be their 4 years. It's their team. Let them do it. Calling out one of the natural leaders on that team because he's at a natural leadership position. We all know that Sam Ehlinger is supposed to be the guy because he kind of fits Tom Herman's mentality. He's wanted to be a Longhorn his entire life. It almost works out like some Disney movie, okay? Mm-hmm. It's about, Sam Ehlinger right across the freeway essentially grew up, across from the Texas Tower, all that kind of stuff in the shadow of it. So it all works out that way. And for Dylan Haynes to call him out, he knew what he was doing. You know what you're doing if you call out Sam Ehlinger. Hell, man, he's got a blue check and you don't. You know what you're doing. Don't act like I was just calling out. No, you knew what you were doing. You wanted to call out Sam, and you know Sam ain't going to back down. Sam should back down.
And this
Sam's been doing that his whole life, too. He's been counted out and having to fight against the grain, and he's one of those guys. He's got a little Wolverine in him. He's got some black badger, some honey badger in him, too. So, yeah, I think Dylan Haynes knew what he was doing. He called him out. And you know what? Mike dropped by Sam Ehlinger. Dylan Haynes, you got schooled. How about that?
And that's the thing. It now plays out in front of everybody to see. But like you said, Rod, first, basically, the person was the personality that would add fuel to the fire instead of calming it down. And then once Haynes goes to that point and gets into the back and forth, you see the senior to the underclassman, the old coach's guy to the new coach, all the different things that make this make sense that you'd be able to have it exponentially maybe, become more than what it maybe was. It could have just been like, say, whenever you were in the locker room and guys going back and forth at each other in the locker room, that happens. The thing is now it's happening out for everybody to see, and that's just the difference. I think it's more of the shift in kids these days. We've seen more and more. We're seeing people Facebook Live from the locker room, and we're seeing stuff that the locker room used to be a sacred spot that people kept the arguments in there. They did it. It was within the team. Nowadays, society doesn't care. There isn't really anything that is sacred. Everything is out there. So I think you're going to see more and more of this. To them, it's just locker room talk. But it's like, well, we're football players, but we are also on social media. Like Johnny Manziel was the first one to have this so blatantly out there that didn't care what everybody else came from. But either way, it's good to see at least you got two guys that are highly motivated and they're on different sides of the ball. That puts well for a competitive practice environment.
Yeah. And Rob, Big Cat Alfio Randall wants to remind you that you guys didn't have social media when you guys played. All you had was Black Planet and Napster.
I wasn't on either one of them. You know what I mean?
What is Black Planet?
But no, I say, now he makes a good point because this wouldn't even be an issue back in the day. We'd have to deal with that. And, you know, Dylan Haynes, like I said, they live out, for some reason, I'm part millennial, have to live out their, like, it didn't happen if we don't document it on social media.
And share it.
You know what I mean? Like,
everybody.
It didn't happen for some reason. I feel you know what I mean? Like, remember the guys going on the boat trip to Miami, the Giants wide receivers, hanging out, smoking blunts on the boat, whatever, with rappers and all this stuff. But
whatever nefarious activities
whatever thing they were doing. And they documented. They took a picture with blunts in their hand. I'm not making that up. And it's like, well, none of that happens. Y'all don't even get in trouble. Nobody cares if y'all don't even take that picture
volunteer
and put it out on social media. Why does it have to be out there?
Right.
The Casey Horney situation, where we talked about him, he's got to put
was
out that he got the job.
Tweet.
I got the job at Texas. Oh, now, boom, you win. Everybody hates him. You know what I mean? Like, if you would just shut up, you know what I mean? Nobody would have knew you got the job. You just snuck in the back door. You know
true.
What I mean? Like, we have to document on social media. That's why I got off Facebook. I love Facebook Live, by the way. I love you guys.
Yes.
But I had to get off of it, man. I don't need to document every part of my life on Facebook and social media, but most people seem to want to go that route. And I think this is another, example of it.
For us being old.
For the record, like you said, I mean, I'm with you, and I believe you, and I've told Wayne McGarity and Johnny Walker and any of the players that I've gotten to know over the years, you guys, and Dylan Haynes is including this.
Dylan Haynes is included.
You guys have the right to
say whatever
complain
you want,
or whatever you want to say about the current program or the current players, whatever you guys want to say. You guys, above all other people, have the right to say that.
Yeah.
Because you guys are the one who dropped sweat and blood and everything else for that program.
Yeah.
So you guys can say it. If this was something that was lighthearted, whatever, that Sam and Dylan know each other, I don't know.
Maybe. And you know what? It's just brothers, too. Like, brothers.
Yeah.
If you have a brother, anybody got a brother out there, do you know there are times you and your brother came to blows? I pulled a knife on my brother one time. Like,
my brother pulled knife on
sibling rivalry.
Hatchets at me.
You know what I mean? Like,
hatchets.
Yeah, so it happens.
My brother stabbed a wall trying to get through
to me. Think about how much stuff you broke because you and your brother got in fights. So,
I broke my hand on my brother's head in seventh grade, and I went and played baseball afterward because I didn't want to tell my parents I broke my hand on his head.
And not saying I was right when I did what I did, or you breaking your hand on your brother's head. But, you know what I mean? That's what brothers get into it like that. So, they're all brothers.
Sort of
like I said, I love them both.
The
Dylan Haynes is fifth all time in interceptions at the University of Texas. For all those who want to hate on Dylan Haynes. All right? You want to hate on the great white hype. Yeah, that's what's going on. You know what I mean? You want to hate on the white safeties? Yeah, Blake Gideon included here. For some reason, Longhorn fans, it's a little racism going on here. You don't want to admit it. You don't want to admit it. You don't like white safeties, okay? You don't like them. You like white wide receivers, that's all good. Well, white safeties, y'all want to hate on them for some reason, but they are my brothers, because I'm a member of DBU, so I'm going to take up for the white safeties, Blake Gideon and Dylan Haynes. Hell, both of those guys. Blake Gideon started more games than any other defensive back in the history of DBU. Dylan Haynes is fifth all-time in interceptions. Both of those guys suck in all of Longhorn fans' eyes.
Yep.
Y'all are obviously being delusional. What makes you delusional? Racism.
Reverse
being racist
racism.
Towards the white safeties. A black man's got to take up for them. During Black History Month, this is a sham.
This is like a Donna Chang whole conversation.
It's ridiculous. I love the white safeties.
You all right, Rod?
Yeah. I don't know. I randomly went there. I don't know if I'm taking up for Dylan Haynes or I'm criticizing. I done both.
Yeah, that was like
five minutes.
Do you need me to make sure
Stephen
I go
A.
like to the coffee pot in the lounge and make sure there's decaf in it?
No,
for
I'm just like,
time.
But people, right, I love they hate it. On Dylan Haynes. Dylan Haynes is fifth. Am I making it up? He's fifth all time in interceptions, I believe, at Texas.
He's in the top 10. I know that. I got to.
Dude, I want to say he's like, dude, I'm telling you. I want to say he's like,
hey, by the way, just guys, real quick.
Look this up.
And while we're on the Sam Ellinger,
oh, yes,
did you see all the photos of him on the ground trailing a defender? Those were some. There
Nathan
like
Basher, Noble Dawes, Jerry Gray, Derek Hatchett, Dylan Haynes.
Nuts.
Ah! Boom!
That's awesome. And Tom Landry can't get no respect.
Longhorn fans are like, oh,
so the three DBs,
they're like
can't
Democrats
get
right now to Trump.
You got Tom Landry, Gideon, and Haynes as the non-respect getting white guys. The Rodney Dangerfields of DBU.
They really are. I didn't make that up, correct?
Let me look it up.
Okay, no, you don't have to look it up.
They're the Rodney Dangerfields.
They really are. Sorry.
By the way, Lamar Houston giving us a shout out on Facebook Live.
What's going on? But yeah, Lamar's he's doing well. Lamar, I know people that stalk you and know you. I keep up with all my Longhorn family via stalking them for people around town that know them. So I've heard Lamar Houston's doing very well. So. Good to hear from him.
Yep, and for Lamar.
Everybody just do your job!
If you haven't heard that, check out our SoundCloud page. Good interview with Lamar from a couple summers ago where we surprised him with some Must Champ sound.
Yeah, Lamar hadn't heard that since he was in the room when that happened.
He loves that sound. We sent that to him, correct?
Yeah, I emailed him a nice best
he loves that sound.
What's a Padawan?
Lamar Houston might have Must Champ like drops as his ringtones.
I hope he does.
Will Must Champ
drops.
It'd
be so cool to be walking around Austin and just hear, I'm going to be me. I'm going to be Will Must Champ.
I'm glad we got on the subject of Will Muschamp. Actually, Dylan Haynes-Rod is tied for fifth in career interceptions.
See? Oh, you hate on the white safeties. Y'all, listen, I know y'all think it's crazy that y'all hate on white safeties, but I think it's a white thing because I respect the white safeties.
Would you like to know who Dylan Haynes is tied with, by the way? This is just some DBU trivia for you later to file away. Well, Chris Carter.
Mm-hmm.
Bobby Dillon. The Sheriff, Stanley Richards. And he's either 1A or 1B on the Mount Rushmore of DBU. One Johnny Johnson.
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, Johnny Johnson is, Johnny Johnson is basically, like, if you talk about one of the founding fathers of DBU.
He's on the Mount Rushmore.
No question. I'm just saying he might be, like, top two. He might be Johnny. Like,
I think it's him or Jerry Gray. Flip a coin.
No, I agree with this.
You know?
No, Johnny Johnson. He's on Twitter, too, by the way.
Johnny is on Twitter, yes. Yeah, and gave a shout-out. To Todd Orlando, and I'm glad we brought up Muschamp because that's one of the things I wanted to talk about this
week. At PapaJohnson28_9, if you want to follow Lifetime Longhorn Johnny Johnson.
That being Kirk's number and Collins' number. Kirk wearing 28.
Oh, yeah.
Colin
I didn't even get to touch that. Good point. Yeah.
Glad we got to defense because, Rod, I have a man crush on a member of Tom Herman's new staff. That being Todd Orlando. And all
is this a long-standing man crush? You had it for a while. Doing some research.
All it took was about a 10 to 11 minute interview on the Longhorn Network.
It took you to get down from your man crush on Yancey McKnight. You had to come down from that man crush.
I really
now
like
you
Yancey
got
McKnight.
Over Yancey McKnight, and now you have a new man crush.
Post Valentine's Day, this is a good subject matter. Who was your Valentine's Day sports man crush? Yeah,
it was Yancey.
Tom Herman was one of mine. I love Tom Herman. I wanted to be one of the players.
Did you use that on the buffet yesterday?
Cheek. No, I haven't. I'm going to use it today now. Matter of fact,
there you go.
Writing it down. That's,
yeah,
that's
write
how
it
I come
down.
Up with material. It's just See? That simple. It's just we're, random rants. And I'm like, oh, that was good.
We're helping Rod here.
I'm using that one.
But I checked out the Longhorn Network interview. It was on signing day. And it's on YouTube. You guys can go find it. Todd Orlando talking about defense. And Rod, I felt good about the direction of the Texas defense after listening to Todd Orlando talk about defense. He wants to be an attacking defense. He wants to be an aggressive defense. He said they are going to be a three-down team, but they're going to play some four-down. It'd be 70%, probably 70% three-down, 30% four-down. They're going to blitz from all different angles, all different positions of blitz. Something we talked about a few weeks ago that I did made some a couple phone calls with some U of H sources and tried to figure it out because I haven't had time to watch a ton of U of H video. This is a field and boundary defense. So
there'll be a field corner and a boundary corner.
Yes.
Yeah.
They are a field and boundary defense. But just listening to him talk about certain positions and three positions he mentioned, Rod, that I want to talk about that are kind of the linchpins of this defense, as he called them. His two inside linebackers, one being the Mac linebacker. And the Rover. Now, the Rover position is one. Now, this might freak some people out. Because when you talk about Malik Jefferson playing on the inside, somebody's like, playing him on the inside last year didn't work, right?
Lord, man, Lord, yeah.
It's just like, how would
I get very upset at the
But if you, I'm going to check Facebook Live, see if there's people like, no, put him on the outside.
We went and got this coach for a reason.
Quit trying to make Malik inside happen, all right?
But here's the thing with Malik.
I know more than y'all do.
But here's the thing with Malik Jefferson playing this Rover position. My understanding is it's the same position Stephen Taylor played at U of H, which if anybody watched U of H, Todd Orlando blitzes his linebackers a lot. and he'll blitz those inside backers from different angles. They'll shoot different gaps. Basically, this is your guy. Basically, your stud, your guy that makes the defense go is that guy playing a rover position. So if that's the case, then it's a good thing to have Malik Jefferson in that role.
Really? So your two best, potentially your two best linebackers going to be inside?
It's the weak side inside linebacker spot, okay. Which if you look at, like, Kansas City Chiefs, Derek Johnson plays that weak side inside.
I gotcha.
At the next level. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. And Stephen Taylor, I can pull up the numbers here for you guys if you guys give me just a second.
My concern would be
Stephen Taylor's production last year. Stephen Taylor had 8.5 sacks, 12 tackles for loss last season. And we know how much U of H got after the quarterback. Mm. And in 2015, Stephen Taylor, 10 sacks, 18.5 tackles for loss.
Okay.
So you can still be really productive playing that weak side inside spot, the rover position, as Todd Orlando calls it. So
he's got the speed for it.
The athleticism.
And this goes back to recruiting, because Gary Johnson said he was recruited by the staff. They said they wanted him to play next to Malik Jefferson. And like a lot of people, that automatically got my wheels turning. Oh, gosh, you're going to put Malik inside. Why? Why are you still banging your head against that wall? But in this position, Rod, it's not what you would think of just sticking him in the middle of the defense and just kind of leaving him be. It's a role, it's a function, and his skill set seems to lend itself really well to what Todd Orlando wants. So my advice to Texas fans would be go watch some U of H film, watch Stephen Taylor, and then give Malik Jefferson a chance to fit into this role and see what happens, because the numbers show he can be really productive if it takes.
I mean, you have enough versatility in different skill sets at the linebacker position to do that. I think what Longhorn fans, what I think worries them, makes them anxious about Malik is, and even with the previous staff and Charlie Strong, even when he was calling the defensive plays, and I think he did a great job improving the defense as a result, I am wary of keeping Malik in any one position.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You never compartmentalize a guy like
right?
that.
Right? Exactly. Ideally, I would like to just, yeah, that as an option, what you just laid out there perfectly. I think that is a great place for him next to Gary Johnson. Basically, your two fastest, most athletic linebackers would be inside. Remind me of San Francisco back when Patrick Willis
and Navarro Bowman.
Yeah, we're inside.
Well, and that's
right?
What I was thinking. Weak side, when you think about, you want to have, if you're having a guy on the weak side and want him to be an impact player, if you put your fastest guy there, he has that range to seal off and save that weak side for any misdirection, because he can make up with the speed,
which
or
is what the
he can chase you down
is.
From behind. So it makes total sense that he's playing that position that we saw Longhorn fans luckily have fresh memory of a guy like DJ or can watch him now. But putting in there makes sense. And I think, like you were saying, Rod, the coaching staff, they seem to be one very open-minded. They would not be one just to compartmentalize. They just think that maybe this is the best place to work him at, because first off, in name rover, why not have your most athletic guy in that position? And then you also know that he's a guy that is willing to go wherever else you need him to fit. But he may be most valuable if he can do the most because of his speed range in that position, because of strictly just his size.
But that
and
also makes it easier to game plan against.
True.
You know what I mean? I'm trying to think of it as a deep, you know what I mean? If you're looking at offensively, if I know where he's going to be every play, then that makes it easier on me if he's the best player. I think you have a defense. I think when you're multiple, it's also got to be in mentality and scheme and philosophy.
Yes, I'm glad you went there.
Like,
yes.
So if you got a Malcolm Roach, a guy that can beat multiple, literally.
Yeah, everything on
you
the
don't
line.
Know even what the hell he can play. I don't even know what he looks
he
like.
He doesn't even play a position.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean?
I've said it before. Reminds me
inside, outside.
Reminds me of Dante Hightower with the Patriots.
Right? Like, I don't even – he's so weird in his bite. Bite is the only thing he's weird at, but I think he's a great skill set. And you know he's got great football IQ.
Right.
That's the guy that can play multiple positions. We know Gary Johnson can play multiple outside or inside. You know Malik can play outside or inside. You know, I don't know if Hager is the guy you want inside necessarily. You probably want him outside a lot of the time. You know what I mean? But my point is, like, you have so many guys that can play outside or inside. Why let the offense know that where those guys are coming from on any given play? Why
Why
give them that advantage?
But that's the thing I like about Todd Orlando, Rod, is he said the goal of his defense is to be multiple, in the sense that these positions – are kind of flexible to where you can show a different number of looks,
yeah,
a different number of fronts, to where it might be the same blitz concept. You're just running it from a completely different front.
Reminds me of Mustard.
He's basically the thing that I really liked about Todd Orlando, to kind of tie all of it together, and we'll continue more on this, obviously, but he's basically looking at it as an offensive approach. in terms of if these offenses are going to throw all these different formations at me, why can't I turn the tables? And if I'm giving them so many looks and so many different fronts and so many things they've got to see pre-snap to throw them off, then that gives me the advantage. I'm the aggressor. I'm on the attack.
Force the substitution.
That's what this Texas defense has been missing. And the one thing he said, Rod, at the beginning of this interview, really, and I'm going to have to paraphrase it because I don't have the quote in front of me, but it's one thing that really you and I both talked about it after the Cal game that just – It was grinding my gears the entire time watching the first half of that Cal game. He said, the way these offenses are constructed, if you just sit back and let it come to you, these offenses will eat you alive.
That's practice for them. They do that. That's 7-on-7. Yes. They do that every day. They've been doing that for years.
Like we talked about in the Cal game, it was just – it was a base front. I think they were – I don't remember if they were 3-down or 4-down in that game, but they were just playing – it was a dime package and just playing like
not
a base
blitzing,
zone
not
coverage.
Coming after
no blitzes,
Davis
nothing.
Yeah.
And then in that offense, you're giving them exactly what they want.
That's what they do. That was the walkthrough they had the day before.
Exactly.
It was just like that. Like, yeah, all right. Oh, there you go. Pitch and catch.
And it was pretty easy. But I just love the mentality that Todd Orlando is going to bring based on this one interview. Now, I could be wrong. I don't know. But, man, I love what I heard in his interview just based on the mentality. Because, Rod, we talk about the offensive identity crisis with this program. Mm-hmm. This program the last couple of years has had a defensive identity crisis. You talk about, well, we want to be in multiple front, but and we've got the we kind of want to be like the Seahawks. But we don't really want to run the same coverages, but we got the same personnel, but we want to do this, but we don't want to be this. Like, at some point, it's like, okay, what are you? Like, how do you define yourself? And I don't know that you could define the Texas defense the last few years.
That's, because what we say definition of something is, right, the identity of it. What do they do well?
Right.
What do they do really, really well? And I don't know if the defense – I think they got to the point where they were pressuring the quarterback really well toward the end of last year, right? They were one of the better teams in the country at actually getting pressure on the
that
quarterback.
That wasn't a problem in the Charlie Strong era. Definitely 14, but even 15 and 16, they were still able to get after the quarterback.
Which I think if you have that, I think that means you have a lot of – because I can't think of the premier pass rusher for Texas. Think about it. Texas got after the quarterback really, really
now
well,
Hager,
right?
Roach, yeah.
Who's their premier pass rusher?
Breckenhager led the team in sacks. He only had 6.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So they kind of they remind me a little of the Texans front. I'm a Texans fan, so forgive me, folks. But the Texans had, even without J.J. Watt, they had a lot of good pass rushers, but not really a premier pass rusher. Jadeveon Clowney, I think, had like 5.5 sacks.
Merciless.
They had Whitney Merciless, who had like 7 sacks or something. They had Benardrick McKinney, who had like 6.5 sacks. You know what I mean? But they were a really good team at getting after the quarterback. But they didn't have a premier pass rusher with Watt out. But with Romeo Crennel, the beauty of that defense, and he runs a multiple defense, 3-4-2, is that he moved those guys around. There'd be times where Jadeveon Clowney would be on the outside. Sometimes he was inside. Benardrick McKinney, outside, inside. He moved those guys around a ton. And they were really good at blitzing from the inside linebacker positions as well. So hopefully, you know, that's what Todd Orlando wants to do. These days, guys, with the package plays and RPOs and all – there are two games being played. There's one pre-snap and there's one post-snap.
Yeah.
All right? If you're a defensive guy, you got to coach them both. If you're just coaching the post-snap, you're doing it wrong.
No.
If you're just coaching post-snap now,
you're already screwed.
You better have Darrell Revis in his prime back there along with, you know what I mean, Antonio Cromartie in his prime back there covering. You know what I mean? You better have premier Alabama-style athletes. And even that showed you when you're going up against Clemson.
Texas.
That may not matter either if that offense is clicking. You know what I mean? But you got to play the pre-snap, which means you got to show them a different look than what they're going to see post-snap. And if your players are not playing that game and also the post-snap game, then you're lost. And that's what Texas wasn't doing enough either under Charlie Strong. And it's probably because they didn't trust those young guys enough to be able to move around and show a shell look, but also, you know, I mean, be able to get to their position and responsibilities post-snap.
Texas in 2016, guys, 5th in the country, 1st in the Big 12 in sacks per game at 3.42, 16th nationally in tackles for loss per game at 7.6, also led the Big 12.
Yeah.
So the big plays are happening, but there's not, like you said, Rod, there's not that one.
Which isn't a bad thing.
Right,
it's
exactly.
Not a bad thing.
I was listening to, you know, you guys know I'm a Cowboys fan, so I listen to a lot of, with the exception of the Astros, I'm a Cowboys fan, I'm a Mavericks fan, so I follow a lot of Dallas sports talk radio. Mm-hmm. And I'm listening to an interview with Goose Goslin for the Dallas Morning News.
I love Goose.
They're talking about the Cowboys need a rusher. They need to draft a pass rusher. They need to maybe trade up to get, Taco Charlton or something. Like, they trade up to get Derek Barnett. Whatever they're going to do.
Hell, they got Randy Gregory with the bus.
Goose's take on it was, and this is one of the, this is maybe about a week ago, but he said, you know, one of his takes on it was, he said, look, you don't get the bang for your buck in free agency signing a pass rusher. Mm-hmm. It's proven you don't, right? Yep. And at 28, the chances of you getting an immediate impact guy are pretty low. It just doesn't usually happen. Not saying it can't, it just doesn't.
Yeah. Because
the Cowboys really, Rod, are a bolstered pass rush away, probably from maybe going to the Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm. Not going to the Super Bowl, but I'm talking about potentially becoming like the next dynasty.
Exactly.
If they can figure it out.
That's pretty much the one thing they're missing is a fortified pass rush. He said the thing you can do, maybe you don't get a 13, 14 sack guy. Maybe you compensate by having maybe three guys that are 8.5, 9 sack guys.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And do it by committee.
That's kind of how you compensate for
that's
that.
Right.
So it may be, you know, they're looking at the Cowboys, looking at maybe one of the ways, maybe you go sign DeMarcus Ware, give him a 2-year deal, maybe $6 million
Cowboy
a year, and just, hey, all we need you to do, big dog, is third down.
Get seven sacks. Get 7-8 sacks.
Exactly. Being so specialized, it's perfect. And you see this across all sports. Like, you're seeing it so much more in baseball with platooning positions, righty, lefties. If you can't get 40 home runs, okay, give me a lefty that hits righties and hits 20 homers and bets 300 and vice versa. Or in basketball, say you got a loaded roster. You don't waste a starter whenever you're going to have usage eaten up. Now you go to the second unit. You have somebody always with the second unit to eat up that usage in the shots, so then you aren't taking away from the first unit's shots. So this is the same idea that you have to be is really just accurate on assessing the field out there and realizing, okay, we can't get a top-end guy. We can't draft one. Okay, the best way to compensate, like, look what Atlanta did. They brought in Dwight Freeney to be a pass rush specialist just for a few downs per, and if you can do that and optimize it now, it's risky because it eats up a roster spot. In the NFL, it's a lot tougher. In college, you can get away with doing a lot more with having 85 scholarships. You can really start to have that type of approach across the board where you do have deficiencies.
And, Rod, I think to your point, the total number of sacks we're talking about, the production overall is nice, but there's no reason why the team leader on this defense should have only 6 sacks. And that's not a knock on Breckenhager
at all. He was phenomenal.
It's just saying
freshman,
the team
leader,
if you're going to be elite, and Rod, I'll go back to what you said several years ago when we were talking about the Texas offense. What are you elite at anything?
Yeah.
And you define it as basically, if you're in that top 10% of programs, you're kind of in that elite. Making plays in the backfield was something Texas was elite at in 2016.
Build your defense around that then.
So why was your defense then so bad? It's because you're not getting it consistently enough. The overall production is there, just not getting it at critical times. And that's when you've got to develop. If Todd Orlando can take Malik Jefferson and say, okay, he's going to be my blitz guy on third down. I'm going to bring him from several multiple different angles, and I'm going to show different shells or whatever to try to get him after the quarterback. You've got your rush linebacker that you can also do that with. I don't know who. Maybe that's Roach, Hager. I don't know. That's going to be one of the interesting things to see during spring ball. It's kind of what he does with all these pieces. Yeah. But if you got a plan, basically, Todd Orlando's plan and kind of what I'm talking about is he wants to get you to third down because he feels like if he gets you in third and medium or long, you're done.
Third and long.
You're done. And, man, go back and watch that Louisville game. And granted, look, Ed Oliver was phenomenal in that Louisville game. But you see just the different looks they presented, how much they confused Lamar Jackson. It's like they're bringing pressure off the boundary, then they drop it, and they bring it from the field side. The disguise, it's one of the best defensive game plans you'll ever see is how U of H defended Louisville. And granted, having a guy like Ed Oliver makes a difference. And while I don't think Texas has an Ed Oliver on this roster,
they don't.
D-line, maybe the best in the Big 12.
They've
though.
got enough guys to where maybe you can,
guys,
you can get that guy. And maybe Jordan Elliott on that one day, maybe he has that kind of impact.
That D-line is symbolic, is perfectly symbolic of what you're saying about you may not have the guy. But, man, if you can moneyball it, you got a lot of different guys there that can play a lot of different roles. You just got to figure out whose skill set fits where.
Right.
You got about 6 or 7 guys in the rotation of the D-line. You just got to figure out who can give you the most.
And that was one of the frustrating things going back to last year. And Elliott was hurt, and it was a shame when he got hurt because that Iowa State game, man, he was looking like an answer.
Yeah.
Like, I walked away from that Iowa State game thinking,
like,
man,
that guy been?
Jordan Elliott looks like he could play at this level and play really well and maybe be, right as you coined the term, kind of that rock of Gibraltar in the middle of a defense that Texas, when Texas has been good defensively.
They got that guy.
Always had that guy.
They do.
But you start thinking about the other pieces, man. DeAndre Christmas should have played more than he did last year, because I asked Charlie about it at a press conference. I said, whenever DeAndre Christmas is on the field, he's making plays. Why isn't he on the field more? And the answer, and I'm not knocking Charlie, it's just the it's an answer in a press conference. You take it for what it's worth. But it was like, well, we got a rotation of guys, and it's kind of how he fits in the rotation. Yeah. And all I'm thinking is, I'm saying that guy needs to be in the rotation more often.
Well, when I see, when you have a rotation where he's not playing that often, and then when I do see him, he stands out, he's making plays. Yeah. Remember, it was like when we saw Deontay Foreman, what was it, like his, was it his freshman year?
Sophomore year. He's got to start.
And we saw, we probably saw him, I don't know, like 15, 20 snaps of him, like somewhere through the season. We were like, dude, why are we seeing Deontay Foreman more? Like, that's ridiculous. Because it doesn't take long to figure out, like, oh, that guy can change the game. I don't know what he does bad, because to figure out what somebody does, like, what they're
bad. It might have been his freshman year, too. But I remember by the midpoint of his sophomore year, we were like, why isn't he getting more carries?
But to figure out what somebody's bad at, that's what a scout's job is to do. It takes – you got to watch some film on it to figure out, you know, what's the uncoachable things within their skill set. But to figure out, like, what somebody's good at, or that guy's a game changer, man, it just takes a few plays to look at him.
Yeah.
And be like, okay. That, like you said, when you go out to a Texas high school football game, just go out there, no knowledge of what the hell's going on, and just sit there and watch a few plays. And then you'll start gathering. 93, 12's a player. You know what I mean? So, you know what I mean? Just start doing kind of the eye test. And, yeah, eye test alone. You should trust the eye test. And he's one of those guys, the eye test, he stood up.
Right. And when you look at this overall with the players that you go and on both sides of the ball try to figure out which where to go and the compartmentalizing that we were talking about before to avoid, it's like necessity is the only thing that is going to allow you to go and go after this platooning area. You only do that if you have to. You don't do that if, say, Christmas is a guy that stands out and he is going to be better. Then that's a luxury. You start that guy. But if you don't have that standout guy, you don't want to compartmentalize yourself into being a rotation team or being a team that is only stuck with the platooning. Once you get that player to stand out, then that will supersede the platooning aspect of it. So that's something to also think about, that you could have a rotation of guys, but once the one emerges, then you don't have to do that. That's just something you do if you need to bring your team along.
Yeah.
Rod, we talked about the two inside linebackers. The other thing Todd Orlando said he really needs to make his defense go, and I'm going to assume this is the field corner he's talking about. Got to have he said a bona fide corner.
You gotta have a bona fide.
I'm guessing like shut down like a legit guy.
Want a guy to get like that's his natural, like that's what he does well. Like he that what sort of anything else, that guy can just straight up cover.
Like you talked about the X-Men ability.
Yeah, exactly. Right. That's his X-Men ability, is that he can cover.
Now
man to man.
We talk a lot of X's and O's, and I've got something on tempo offenses for you that I want to make sure we hit on because I think you'll love it. I don't know if you've seen it before we get out of here. But one thing, can you break down for everybody? I know my X's and O's, but I yield to Rod when it comes to DB matters because I know you don't get to talk about it enough.
Yeah.
Break down for everybody, if you're a field and boundary defense, what skill sets would you ideally like in a field corner? What skill sets would you ideally like in a boundary corner?
It's interesting. I mean, there are different philosophies. In your field corner, that guy, he is going to be vulnerable because he's got a lot more ground to cover.
Yeah, if people aren't sure, field's the wide side, boundary's the shorter side to the line of scrimmage. It's more so a factor in college because of the wider hashes.
Exactly. So based on where the ball is on the hash, if you got a field corner, I mean, that guy has to cover a ton. And sometimes they can single that guy out, put that guy out there with just one wide receiver.
It'd be like 35 yards and 20 yards.
Yes, you know, giving him even more field to cover. Yeah, so it depends on how you want their technique. Is he a guy that plays bump and run with that much field to cover? Then he leaves himself open and vulnerable to the big plays. You want a guy whose technique is natural, not as flawless, but you want a guy that's really good technique out there because, you know, double moves you're going to be vulnerable to. There's so many different ways to attack that guy. And if you're playing a zone coverage or a man coverage or a man zone concept, that guy is more vulnerable probably than any other player on the defense is the field corner. So you need a straight up, junkyard dog out there. He just have a junkyard dog kind of mentality. He's going to get attacked a lot. And if you end up getting a shutdown guy out there, the beauty of that is you end up getting a guy with a reputation as being kind of a shutdown corner, a playmaking corner as your field guy, then it really limits what teams can do. You know what I mean? Like, so they're like, all right, I don't want to attack that guy, but damn, that guy's he's on the field side. He's where most of the space is. And what are these spread offenses built on attacking?
Exactly.
Space. All right, they want to get in space, and you get a guy basically that ends up can shut down, I don't know, maybe a third or a quarter of the field, depending on the formation and the personnel set. So I think that is – I never played in a system with a field in a boundary corner. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We would either play – you'd play right or left, or you'd play we'd play man-to-man, and you would track your man, as they say. You know what I mean? So I got a lot of respect for guys that can play the field like that, because you got to play zone and man as that field corner. Boundary corner, you want a guy that's usually that guy that's more physical. That's a guy that, I mean, sometimes you can see those guys play what's called a split coverage, where they'll play a different coverage to the field side with the field corner, and you may get a cover two to the boundary side. Right. You know what I mean? Turn that guy into a run support guy. So usually that guy's more physical. He's usually a great tackler. He's got a lot of, like, I know it sounds crazy, but, you know, a guy like Quandre Diggs wouldn't be a bad boundary corner.
Wasn't Derek Straight a boundary corner?
Derek
when he was
Straight
at Oklahoma?
Was, yeah. But yeah, you know what I mean. Like, yeah. And that guy can play the cover two really well. Loves to come up and run support. Can get his hands on wide receivers. Usually it's something quick because it's too, you know, the ball's coming out quick there to the boundary. So, you know, the quarterback loves the quick game there. Guys, like, he's got natural instincts. A Derek Straight was perfect for that. And Derek Straight kind of reminds me a little bit in skill set of a Quandre Diggs, you know what I mean? And, yeah, so, I you know, there are certain guys who have a skill set. Coaches can identify it based on their philosophy. Like, oh, that guy's a skill set to be a boundary corner. Oh, this guy's a skill set to be a field corner.
With that in mind, Rod, not to cut you off,
no,
but we look at the Texas defense. Am I crazy to think that if you're going to see who is ideal for that field corner position?
That's a good question.
I look at Chris Boyd, man, and the job he did last year, which good basically, question. If you look at the second half of last year, they basically turned Chris Boyd into a field corner.
They did.
They had Chris Boyd playing the field side, John Bonney playing the boundary side.
Yeah.
I just think, you know, and this is no disrespect to Holton Hill or Devontae Davis, any of the corners on the roster, I just look at Chris Boyd and the phrase you said that makes me think Chris Boyd is junkyard dog mentality.
Yeah, that's a good point.
The guy that's just like,
they're going to attack him, but you're going to pay.
Yeah.
You may come and give me a couple of times, but you're going to pay. Keep attacking.
At some point, you will.
Yeah, I agree with that. And he, you know what? That's a good point, because he was, because at first, remember, we talked about it on the Blitz. They were playing, I've never seen it before. Remember, we talked about it. They were playing him literally on the Texas side.
Oh.
For like three or four games, it wasn't field and boundary. It wasn't right left. It wasn't man to man. They literally were just playing Chris Boyd where the coaches could yell at him.
And so he could hear him
distance.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
But
he made a ton of plays
right,
on those sidelines, right?
Just
and then the Tech game, he only, you know, there was a play where he should have made, and the Tech game in the back, all that kind of stuff. Well, I think as the season went on, they started using him more as kind of the field corner. And Bonnie is kind of the boundary corner, which ideally Bonnie's bigger, or Devontae Davis, or even Holton Hill, excuse me. Those guys are bigger. Those guys kind of fit that boundary corner what we were talking about. You know what I mean? And Chris Boyd is the, you know, he's got that junkyard dog mentality. And maybe he's your most natural cover man. And if you got, you want a guy out there that can just straight up cover in the end.
So that's kind of where I was just listening to that Todd Orlando interview and going through some of it. I just thought it was phenomenal. And
what did he say about safeties? Did he say anything about his safeties?
Didn't say a whole lot about the safeties.
Okay.
No. Right. But that's a position. We talked about that last week. I mean, that's a spot where Texas is going to have to figure out a way to get more playmaking ability, more speed on the field, which that means Brandon Jones has to be on the field. You got to find a way to get
that guy on the field.
You got to
get that guy on the field, man. He's a playmaker. He's one of those guys. Remember the few plays, special teams, he comes out there, he's blocking kicks. You're like, oh, yeah. Brandon Jones is
it's
blocking
like first
kicks.
First play of the game.
Texas had two safeties last year, Brandon Jones and Deshaun Elliott. Now, Brandon Jones struggled a little bit when he was out there. Some of the stuff you
freshman.
Expect from freshmen.
He's a true freshman.
But when Deshaun Elliott's out there, Deshaun Elliott's making plays. And it's kind of like, it goes back to the Christmas thing. Like, okay, when Deshaun Elliott's in there, he's making plays. He's not in there enough. Mm-hmm. Get him on the field more.
Yeah.
I want to see him on the field.
I know Longhorn fans are like, take out Dylan Haynes and put in Deshaun Elliott and Brandon Jones. Like, well, you know, Dylan Haynes was making picks out there. And
right.
People don't like the Dylan Haynes picks because they weren't glamorous enough. They were always like a quarterback's kind of junk throw, but he was in the right place at the right time.
This is
I don't like white people.
This is
I had that earlier, but I didn't have a timely part. I heard the name. I'm like, boom.
That was great.
Thank you.
Love it.
This is 2 weeks in a row where we've talked a lot of defense. So next week we'll talk offense. There's an availability with the offensive staff
tomorrow. We talk offense all the time,
right?
Man.
There's and defense. You know, defense, Rod. You're at home when we talk.
Where's the war on defense lately, man? Defense can't. You know, it's been tough on defense.
We get to talk coverages and blitzes. And
nobody
shells.
Cares about defense anymore. Nobody cares about it anymore. Everybody cares about offense,
right?
Like we talk about, especially in the Big 12.
We'll talk about some offense next week, but defense. The defensive conversation fascinates me. And one guy that we talk about this a little bit, Rob, but I listened to Todd Orlando talk. You talk about the safeties and guys playing different positions and functioning different ways. I want to see what Todd Orlando does with a guy like Jason Hall. And could
you thought about experimenting with Jason Hall.
Could you make him maybe not move him to linebacker per se, but just make him like a box safety,
hybrid?
That hybrid position that the NFL is going to, where he's a safety linebacker.
They call it the big safety package, where they have a guy, basically three safeties, but one is just a freak hybrid guy that you want covering tight ends and H-backs. Yeah.
I really want to see what Jason Hall could do in a position like that. Like, that's why I think
– it'll work in the Big 12, man.
As long as Jason Hall plays his senior year the way he pretty much did after he was benched as a junior, when he had that really good game against Oklahoma State, and then he was – from what I remember, just pretty solid the rest of the year. If you get that Jason Hall all 12 and then 12 games, then a bowl game as a senior, call me crazy, but I think he's going to have a shot to make an NFL roster, given the way the game is going. Somebody's going to be intrigued enough to at least get him in camp and take a look.
He's got enough on film where somebody will roll the dice on him and bring him in camp. I agree with you on that.
Especially with sub-packages and a hybrid role.
He's still got another year to show off. Right. Something with this group, and you never know, you might show off more versatility, as you pointed out, the linebacker position. I like your suggestion, man, about the big nickel. We've talked about this on the show. I think back when Muschamp, maybe it was way back, maybe we talked about like a Mac Brown era about like a big nickel package with teams playing against like K-State. And even, I know it sounds crazy, like, well, not Baylor now, but we don't know what Baylor's offense is going to look like now. But when Baylor used
they
to
want to slow it down, apparently.
They want to slow it down. You know what I mean? So, you know, K-State, Oklahoma State with their, what do they call it? What's their cowboy
H-back, back,
whatever they
the
have.
Cowboy back.
You know what I mean? Like, when you have those types of matchups, man, those big safeties, that big safety package is perfect, that hybrid role of a guy like Jason Hall. He can stop the run, but he also can cover the, you know, the cowboy H-back or that K-State H-back they always use.
Rod, you
by the way, prayers and thoughts out to Bill Snyder.
Absolutely. I want to touch on that a little bit later, but we go ahead and do it now.
Yeah.
Rod, you played against Bill Snyder coach teams. There's not he's the guy that still writes handwritten notes to players,
straight
the guys
class,
that he respects.
Man.
Maybe
you could argue that he's out of championship. He's the greatest maybe coach in the history of college football without a championship. And he's better than some coaches with championships.
Yeah, given what he did at K-State. And people forget, before he got there, K-State was the worst program in FBS.
Oh, I got a stat for you. I think it was like, and I hope I get it right, from 1935 to 1990 or something like that, they won at least five games only four times. And since then, Bill Snyder has won, I believe it is, he's won at least five conference games 13 times. Just conference games alone. I didn't even consider it.
In 25 years.
Yeah, I mean, that
25
dude
seasons.
Took time off. You know what I mean? Now he plays in a stadium that's named after him. How many people do that? Has that ever happened
after
before?
Retiring. After retiring a statue and you come back
he
to
plays
play with
in a stadium that is
Saban.
That is
Saban
so gangster.
Has one.
That is so straight up gangster, dog. How clean? How cool
Saban
is that?
And Tebow. You had a Tebow and Saban. That's the only one. You have to be in the SEC or be Snyder.
Tom Osborne. I don't know if they dedicated the field when Tom. Osborne had retired.
Guy's Taco Bell still every day.
Lavelle Edwards at BYU might have coached in Lavelle Edwards Stadium when it was rededicated. But yeah, the point is the list is small.
The list is small. That guy's he's a legend. A lot of ways.
Absolutely. Cancer sucks. It does. Yeah. No two ways around it. So, absolute thoughts and prayers with Coach Snyder.
And also, while we're on that topic, I saw this morning Ron Gardenhire, the Longhorn. He was just diagnosed with prostate cancer. He's with the Diamondbacks, but another lifetime Longhorn to bring up since you're on the topic.
Yeah.
So, I want to. We got a few minutes left, Rod. I want to get your take on this. We talk about tempo offenses. This is kind of our X's and O's talking. And trust me, we've got plenty of podcasts to get into. personnel and spring ball and all kinds of stuff. So we just kind of
We got so much time.
This is the point in the podcast calendar where we just kind of throw it at the wall and see what sticks and bounce it off each other and see what
it's just football talk. It's kind of football porn to me. I love it.
It really is.
Here's another Snyder nugget real quick. In the, it was 96 years of Kansas State football prior to him, we ended up only winning 316 games. In the last, 20 years, he's won 202.
Wow.
Yes. They had 316 from 1893 to 1989. Wow. That's how long. And he almost matched that since 1989.
Dude's awesome.
Yeah, it's insane.
So, Rod, I don't know if you've seen this or read it, but Tom Brady did an interview with Peter King.
Oh, I saw some snippets from this. This is about his aging, right, and all that?
About
how he feels good and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, I read some of that.
Right. Hang on just a sec. Let me make sure I've got this right.
Yeah, I read that. Tom Brady is, I know, I'm a huge Tom Brady fan for those who don't know. People hate on that. I love Tom Brady. He is the greatest quarterback of all time. You know, you can't deny that. But that damn jersey is missing, people. The Super Bowl 51 jersey.
And Arda Acevedo has better things to do.
Here's the theory. You know who has it? Vladimir Putin. y'all laughing. Okay. This is a fact. Y'all laughing. This is a fact. Fact. Vladimir Putin has a Patriots Super Bowl ring.
He stole it from
Robert Kraft.
Yes.
One day, Robert Kraft and Vladimir Putin are hanging out, billionaires, and Vladimir Putin hanging out somewhere in some dungeon somewhere where he probably has, like, the OJ knife and other stuff, and just kicking it. And he takes the Super Bowl ring from Robert Kraft, tries it on, never gives it back.
No.
Robert Kraft's so afraid of an international incident, he doesn't even bring it up. He probably tells Trump about it before he's president. Maybe Trump can do something about it now, but who knows. And I think Vladimir Putin, I think he sanctioned an Ocean's 11 type heist in H-Town to get that damn jersey, and he's going to flaunt it one day and talk about how these silly Americans, I can do whatever I want to them. I'm Vladimir Putin. He's going to have like a Super Bowl ring, and he's going to be wearing Tom Brady's jersey, or he's just using it in his sex dungeon to do kinky stuff with hookers.
Can we mark Rod's Russian accent and mirror that with his Sammy Sosa Jamaican
this
accent?
This is Sammy Sosa, the one and only.
Yes, I was about to say all accents by Rod sound the same. Jamaicans
this
are
is true.
Russians.
Could so, also be that Roger Goodell stole the jersey just so he could burn it because he hates Tom Brady that much. He wanted to burn
that's
it.
That's your people
backyard.
In Houston, though, Rod, getting you know stuff stolen.
Mm-hmm.
That's your people.
Maybe some undocumented workers stole it because they hate Trump and they know Trump loves Brady. Boom, they took it to Mexico and they're like, you build the wall, but you'll never get Brady's jersey back. Boom!
Very all well right. could have been.
That's conspiracy theories with Rod Babers here on Longhorn Blitz.
What happened to
why not?
But no, so this is describing the a touchdown pass in the Super Bowl from Tom Brady to Danny Amendola. And it's talking about there's 31 seconds left on the play clock when Brady's back in the shotgun. The receivers are fanning out. Brady sees kind of a side adjustment that he can make. With 21 seconds left on the clock, Brady changes the play. He gives Amendola a sign. Amendola moves out a couple of steps. Jalen Collins, the guy that's covering him, does nothing. Brady can now hear a coach, and it's Josh McDaniels talking to him at the 15-second mark on the play clock. They're talking about the signal was kind of mixed. But basically – it's the Patriots are running kind of hurry up, no huddle. And basically, you've got all this time on the play clock to make side adjustments, get communication, and it goes on
get
to say
the blocking
this.
Blocking assignments.
One of the benefits of running a tempo offense is you've got a trusted voice in your ear. Brady said he likes McDaniel's reminders because they're not oppressive or unrelenting. They're notes based on what McDaniel's is seeing from the sideline. This is a fascinating quote from Tom Brady, given the way we know the kind of the negative stigma that no huddle offense is. That's kind of a double negative I use there, but the stigma that no huddle offenses have in college. This is the Tom Brady quote. Quote, no question, part of the advantage of going fast is the coach-to-quarterback communication, Brady said. If you're set at the line with 31 seconds left, there are two advantages. You limit defensive substitutions, and a second set of eyes can help you. So for all the talk about, coaches are calling it from the sidelines, this is maybe the best quarterback the game has ever seen doing the exact same thing.
He's getting in his headset as opposed to the college. They're getting signals. And,
it's a different
poster boards and all that kind of stuff.
But it's the same. The end game
concept,
is the same. The process
same
of getting
concept,
there is different.
Same philosophy. I agree with you. And I never thought about that. And I got to tell you, consider myself kind of a football philosopher, if you will. I got to admit, I mean, it's just I've been saying for a while that I think we're at the point in football, and just talking about the game overall, the macro.
This is why I brought this up, because I wanted to get your take.
I don't know if the defense ever catches up again.
The
advantages have become so
yeah,
you know what I mean.
Gonna be my question
Grand Canyon like they talk about the RPOs, and now you talk about two eyes looking at what the defense is doing. No substitutions, the hurry up, everything. Rub. I mean, you go on and on. I mean, there's so many advantages. The rules.
And
the rules are slanted toward the offense. There's so many advantages now. I wonder if we need to just stop being so hard on defensive. I mean, look at Nick Saban. Hell, he can't figure it out now. Nick Saban literally cannot figure it out.
Yeah.
He's admitted. Go look at the last three. Go look at Nick Saban since 2010, since he played Texas, 2010. And go look at his defenses from like 2009 to like 2012. And then look at them since like post Johnny Manziel era like that. I mean, he struggled versus them offenses too. He can't figure it out. Nobody can figure it out. And maybe because it's one of those conundrums that we never solve. Maybe it's to the point now where the offenses have kind of took a evolutionary leap to the point where the defenses, they just cannot catch up unless you have the best athletes available. And even Nick Saban, 5-star athletes and all, can't really figure it out. We know it takes talent to play defense. Like, right. You can't play good defense. This is why the Big 12 sucks at defense, right? The Big 12 doesn't have a lot of talent. The Big 12, as a whole, had 18 players sent to the NFL Combine.
It's
19 this year.
Officially, but yes, points officially could still stand here.
19. Hell, A&M had 9 their own, okay? I think the SEC had like 66 or something like that. You know what I mean? That's how – matter of fact, I think the ACC and the Pac-12 had like 47 and 50-something. We had 18.
Not good.
You need talent to play defense. To play offense, hell, you don't need talent. Ask Texas Tech. Ask Baylor.
Yeah.
Ask SMU, ask Washington State. You don't need talent to play offense. You need a scheme, and you need different skill sets.
In
but if you want to play good defense, if you want to play championship-level defense, you got to have talent, man. You ain't no other way around. You got scrubs out on that field playing defense, they will be exposed. And that's what's happening in the Big 12, scrubs being exposed. I don't mean to call guys scrubs, but you get my point. TLC, I don't want no scrubs. But you get my point, and that's why I think it's going on. That's why the leaps right now offensively, not even the talent of Alabama has been able to catch up. And he's the greatest defensive mind we've ever seen at the college level.
Yeah, and that's why I think that what you're saying right there, right, it makes total sense that in the NFL, all the guys at the top are these veteran quarterbacks with the minds that now can win the pre-snap ability to where you'll see them continue to be the ones that always are the ones at least being able to, every single play, you can always out-counter the defense to your point. But when you look at going forward and where the minds would send you, you look at offense, the only way to counter that, like you were saying, is that defensive side. So be interesting to see how fast it can get up. It's just the normalizing that you get to, it's sort of like how you explained who the best comedian or best actors are. They aren't actors, they're comedians, because you have to do it impromptu. Mm-hmm. The best quarterbacks are going to be the ones that you put them out on the field, impromptu situation, go, what can you do to win? And that's why you're seeing the Breeze, the Bradys, all these guys that had the mind, they've been able to get in any situation and they can win with it, especially if you have a second pair of eyeballs. So instead of how it used to be, the movie stars were the famous ones, but they could do it and have it be scripted and take time. Now it's like the comedians that have to go out there and do it impromptu immediately and perform every single play.
Doesn't the middle linebacker in the NFL also have headset? Can't talk to his defensive coordinator.
One defender gets one.
You know what I mean? It's different. You know what I mean? So
they're probably doing the same there.
But it's just so how natural football is. You're reacting, though.
As
a defender, when I'm covering a wide receiver, what the hell you going to do. Know what the hell y'all going to do. Yeah. I'm literally reacting every second off of you. So I'm always naturally behind.
Yep.
And I think that's kind of what's happening, too, with, like, even if they both have two eyes on what the offense is doing, but they're reacting to what the offense is doing. You know what I mean? So they're always at a disadvantage.
It's an interesting conversation.
It's a good conversation.
We will definitely have to pick that up again at some
point. Deep.
But that is going to do it for this edition of Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. Matt. Appreciate it, man.
Yeah, you are more than welcome.
Happy birthday, sir.
Happy birthday, bro.
Appreciate it.
Rob B, appreciate the time and the knowledge.
Always fun.
Happy birthday, Chris Farley. I love having the same birthday as Chris Farley.
The late great Chris Farley. Yes, absolutely. For Matt, for Rod, for Travis, the best damn videographer in a podcast game who recorded our audience on Facebook Live. Thanks for everybody, to everybody for downloading and for listening to this episode of Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. You can get this at am1300thezone.com. Get us on iTunes, TuneIn, SoundCloud, Matt, and any podcast app.
Yep, just type in Longhorn Blitz.
For the Zone family, for the Horns 24/7 family, I'm Jeff Howe. Thank you so much for downloading and listening, and we will catch you again on the next episode.
Awesome.
Almost over. Done.
You've been listening to Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com. Remember, for the latest Longhorn news 24/7, visit horns247.com.